Hi guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and today we're going to look up night skirts. Hey guys, thanks for joining me again today. We are going to be talking about groin protection today. So before we get started, one of the most important things to understand is that we kind of have this modern preoccupation with protecting the groin. And we also make the mistake of looking at male as inadequate protection for the groin. But what we're going to see is that through the bulk of the High Middle Ages into the Late Middle Ages, even into the Renaissance, that male was considered perfectly adequate primary protection for the groin. So going back basically through the entirety of the High Middle Ages, what we see is that the groin is protected primarily by the male hauberk, so basically the skirt of the male hauberk hanging down. If you look at the Bayeux tapestry, that's really all you see. Into the 12th and 13th centuries, the male hauberk is the primary defense for the groin. Even into the 14th century, where the skirt length shortens a bit, it's still long enough to be the primary protection for the groin. Don't make the mistake of looking at a 14th century armor with nothing but the skirt of mail hanging down and assuming that the groin is not protected. Now, there is some experimentation in the rest of the Middle Ages with dedicated equipment for protecting the groin. So we're going to take a look at that now, but don't dismiss just a male skirt as completely inadequate protection, because that's not true. A couple of things to keep in mind. A lot of armor was being used on horseback, so having 1,000 pounds of horse between your legs is pretty good protection for the groin. Even on foot armor that may have been dedicated to foot armor or optimized for use on foot, the way that you fight, again, you're not going to present vulnerabilities as an easy target for your opponent. So the other thing you can't get around is the need for mobility through the groin. As you fight, it's not a static activity where only your upper body is in use. You're constantly in motion. You're constantly utilizing your legs. And in order to do so, you generate a lot of movement through the groin. Because of that, if you start to encase that in steel, you're going to start to severely restrict that movement. So that is, of course, another concern. And what you're going to see is, especially later on, the difference between dedicated tournament armor, where they could accept these restrictions, have a lot of the features that people are concerned about like almost completely encasing themselves in steel, but these were for tournament use. In actual warfare, you needed to be mobile. The need for mobility outweighed the concern of complete protection of the human body. Otherwise, you simply can't fight, and ultimately, you're actually less survivable when you're unable to fight like that. So let's look at some of the innovations that were used specifically for protecting the groin. But the important thing to keep in mind through all this is that these methods are not universal, and just using a male skirt is kind of never going to go away. So in the 14th century, one of the things we see is what I'm going to refer to as like a groin flap of mail. When we look at some 14th century survivals and artwork, we see stuff like this. So this is a male shirt, and what you see is on the back of the male shirt, there's basically a flap of mail that hangs down that you can grab and pull and draw up through your through the middle of your legs and then attach in the front, so that you basically get the end result of something like this. We have this flap of mail that goes between the legs and secures in the front to provide a closer protection of mail as opposed to just the hanging hem of the skirt. So if something does get up underneath there is at least one layer of mail protecting the groin directly. And if you look at some artwork from the 14th century, here's a late 14th century statue. This is from the same statue. If you look here, you'll see very similar to what we saw in that survival. So here is here you can see the interrupted hem of the skirt and then the flap being drawn up through the legs and secured in the front to protect the groin, more than just the skirt can do on its own. Now, into the 15th century, we start to see other innovations with mail, specifically what would be referred to as a mail braette or mail briefs, but it's basically a diaper or a pair of underwear made of mail. So we do see some interesting artwork from the 14th century that suggests there may have been braillettes, but we don't know for sure because they don't show up in inventories or actual survivals until the 15th century. But what we see here is on this silver statue of St. George, you'll notice he has an uninterrupted hem of mail on his skirt. And then just below that at the top of his legs, you can see that his the upper leg is wrapped in mail. I'm going to put a link in the description below to a better album of photos of this particular statue, but when you look at it from the back, you can see that he's not wearing full mail leggings. The mail is only encasing the very upper part of his legs. And this would give the same visual as if he was wearing mail braillette. So it's a possibility that they were at least known in the very late 14th century. So this is what a braillette looks like. This is an example from Chicago, I believe, is where the museum where this is being held. This is a 15th century example of a braillette being laid out flat. When it's actually being worn, it would look something more like this. So you'll basically get that diaper look of mail. This is a reproduction of a braillette made by Tom Billiter, who runs Historically Patterned Mail. I'll put a link in the description for that as well. And this is what his looks like laid out flat on the floor. And then being worn, you can see it gives that similar impression to what we saw on the silver statue of St. George, where the upper leg is encased in mail. In artwork of the 15th century, you'll see things like the tomb of Richard Beauchamp, Earl of Warwick. When you look closely, you'll see he has, again, an uninterrupted skirt of mail, and then in between his legs, you'll see additional mail there, likely something like a braillette or something similar. Here's a later 15th century example from the Netherlands, again, uninterrupted skirt of mail, and then mail seen clearly between the legs. So what about plate protection for the groin? One of the earliest innovations that we see for dedicated protection for the groin using plate is, of course, the fald. So the fald is the skirt of plates that is either attached to the cuirass or it's a discrete ponce of plates, as we see in some inventories where the fald was an entirely separate piece. But the point is that it can be made long enough to directly protect the groin. So there are short falds, there are long falds. There are clearly falds that exist through the late Middle Ages that would never be long enough to protect the groin, but they definitely made them long enough at some points to do that job. So here you can see in artwork falds of length that are long enough to actually provide protection for the groin. So remember, these collapse so they can still be used on horseback, but ultimately the longer you make a fald, the more restricted you're going to be in movement. So you can't just make it indefinitely long without introducing some serious disadvantages, but they clearly did use falds that were long enough to provide direct protection for the groin. But for as many falds as we see that are long enough, there are counterexamples of falds that were pretty short. Some of them are really short that clearly wouldn't provide any additional protection for the groin. One interesting way around that is in the late 14th century, we start to see another innovation called, there really is no specific name for it that I'm aware of. It's usually referred to kind of affectionately as a DPU, Dick Protection Unit, basically. So what it is basically a triangular fald that's attached to the remainder of the fald to provide exclusive protection for the groin. So here on the Pistoia altarpiece, second in from the left, you see the guy facing us. The rest of his fald kind of ends around the level of his plaque belt, but he has additional lames that come down to protect the groin. And we'll see that in artwork through the late 14th century and into the early 15th century. Again, this is not universal. But it was something that was being tried. So here are some more examples of that. And we see this not only on in manuscript images, but we also see this on effigies and funerary brasses and things like that. Basically, additional lames attached to the fald, or sometimes just a single lame attached to the fald that comes down between the legs and protects the groin without affecting movement of the rest of the leg. This, the DPU kind of disappears around 1430. That's at least the latest that I was able to find them. They kind of sort of taper off at that point, and then they're not really seen anymore, from what I could tell. Now, another interesting example of dedicated plate protection for the groin shows up in later 15th century Gothic artwork. There are no survivals of anything like this that I'm aware of, and it only shows up in a few pieces of Gothic artwork. But clearly, when looking at this painting, for example, you can see he's wearing a short fald that wouldn't provide direct protection for the groin, but clearly underneath there is what looks like a dedicated piece of plate equipment, potentially even articulated plate equipment, because it looks like it has individual lames, for protecting the groin. So there's one example. It's a little bit harder to see in this example, but if you look, again, he has a very short fald, very conducive to wear on horseback, something like that. But underneath, you can make out what looks like individual lames of plate protecting the groin. And then here's a very clear example. Again, short fald with what looks like some sort of articulated plate protection there for the groin. Again, no survivals of anything like this, but it does show up in Gothic artwork, so it's possible that they were also experimenting with things like this in the late 15th century. And then finally, moving into the 16th century, you have a couple different approaches here. A lot of armor, though, what you see is basically a configuration like this. So you have a fald with a high cutout so that it's easy to wear on horseback, and nothing but the male braet in this case being used as the primary defense for the groin. Again, on horseback, not as much of a concern, but showing that the need to protect the groin directly with plate armor wasn't always of primary concern. Here's another example of a 16th century plate armor configured the same way. And then you have what is called tunnelet armor. So this is the foot combat tournament armor that belonged to one of the foot combat tournament armors that belonged to Henry VIII. Operative word being tournament armor. This is a tunnelet armor. So that has that really kind of exaggerated large fald. The difference between this and a lot of other falds is that this is projected considerably away from the body and is considerably larger than the falds that we're used to seeing on actual war armors. So this is going to start to now get into the realm of tournament armors, where they're considerably more massive than armors that are actually dedicated to warfare. So they're going to be heavier, they're going to be larger, they're going to be more difficult to move in. But these things were exclusively dedicated for tournament use, but I didn't want to leave this out so that you could at least see this clearly would protect the groin. And then, of course, you have everybody's favorite thing in the 16th century is the exaggerated plate codpiece. So you see things like this usually on highly decorated armors. Here's an example, and here's another tournament foot combat armor that belonged to Henry VIII. And now you can see we have complete protection of the inside of the joints with compression lames on both the inside of the elbow, the back of the knee, the pelvis, and even his rear end is completely encased in steel. And of course, to top it all off, he has to have this ridiculous codpiece. So sometimes when looking at things like this, you have to remember who these armors belong to and what they are being used for. And a lot of times you see these exaggerated codpieces on tournament armors, on armors of very high status individuals, where decoration and status and kind of asserting their place in the hierarchy was just as important as being protected. So I often think that the exaggerated codpiece is really more for show than it is for actual protection, even if it did provide that kind of side benefit. So I hope that this video has answered a lot of questions about groin protection. Hopefully you guys realize that the important thing to keep in mind here is that it didn't necessarily need its own dedicated piece of equipment in order to be protected. There was definitely a lot of experimentation and innovation through the late Middle Ages for ways to better protect the groin, but mail never went away as a primary defense for the groin. And there's, like we said, a lot of other contextual things to consider. Was the armor specifically for foot combat? Were you expected to be on horseback? Was this a dedicated tournament armor? That tends to make a huge difference in the way that the armor is built and configured. So don't ignore things like that. And as always, if you guys enjoyed the video, please give me a thumbs up, subscribe if you haven't already. Please share my channel with your friends if you enjoy it. I appreciate it very much so. If you have any questions or comments, please leave those down below. I always make my best effort to get to as many of those as I can. And thank you for watching. We'll be back soon with another video. Thanks.